much. It's a very great pleasure to be here. Ed is one of my most treasured colleagues, so it's a particular honor to be here. It's my first visit to this gorgeous campus. I told Ed I had no idea we had such a beautiful campus in the middle of the city, and it's very easy to miss it by being, you know, I'm only driven by on the main road, so I'm very, very pleased to be here. So two small corrections. Ed is not as full of the field, and please use the microphone, please.
Yeah,
is this better?
Yeah.
Okay. Ed is not an expert in the field of credit risk. He is, I think, the expert in the field of credit risk. He knows every data point like a personal friend. When other people are worried about recessions, Ed has an extra spring in his step as he's collecting default data. So second thing, I'm particularly honored to be here today for the Edward Altman lecture, because last week Ed officially went emeritus and I received his chair. So I'm now the backstage. So thank you very much. And so my talk today is going to be on credit derivatives, as I mentioned, the good features, the bad features, and the concerning features, the worrying features of this market. Now, a word of apology at the outset. I don't know how familiar all of you are with the derivatives world. So I will try to presume as little knowledge as possible. If you find it little boring, just signal to me and I'll try and speed up a little bit. So originally when I prepared, I had no idea how long a talk I was to prepare for. So I put in a lot of slides, and you know, all of you know, you're all academics here. You like nothing more than a captive audience in a closed room. But then I was reminded by Ed in the cab on the way over here that I was, as chair of the NYU Faculty Senate, I'm also hosting a dinner for the trustees today in Battery Park City at 7 o'clock. So I'm going to be late, of course, but I told them I'd try not to be too late for the event. So let me just begin with the talk. So what credit derivatives have been in the news in a very big way in the last 6 or 7 years, since the financial crisis, I suspect that outside people in the financial sector and finance academics, nobody had really heard of credit derivatives till the crisis actually began. Now, conventionally, finance has always distinguished between two kinds of risk. Market risk, which is the risk of changes of prices of various sorts, to which companies and investors are routinely exposed, and credit risk, which is the risk that the promised payment will fail to materialize. So market risk is everyday risk, but credit risk is more event risk that we face when a promised payment fails to materialize. And the world of derivatives has grown up over the last 4,000 years to handle this kind of risk, to give people instruments to handle risk. Forwards were created more than 4,000 years ago, futures came out of that, options, swaps. To handle market risk, prices of various sorts, we have various derivatives to enable handling of those risks. But to handle credit risk, the idea of a derivative security that enables handling credit risk is a relatively new idea in finance, and it was born only in 1994 when J.P. Morgan Chase introduced the first credit. So what is a credit derivative? I'll give a more precise definition in about 5 minutes, but loosely speaking, a credit derivative is an instrument that enables you to strip the credit risk in a security and sell away the credit risk to somebody else. So it enables you to manage the credit risk in your portfolio by taking out risk that you don't want to keep in your portfolio. Essentially, it makes trading and credit feasible. Now, to put credit derivatives in context in the market, if you look at the overall size of the world derivatives market and what kind of risks are being transferred through these instruments. So this is a graph that looks at the total size of the world derivatives market measured in billions of US dollars. According to the nature of the underlying risk that is being transferred through the instrument. So interstate derivatives that transfer interstate risk account for more than 80% of the world derivatives market. The second largest component of the market are derivatives that transfer FX foreign exchange. Credit derivatives are only the third largest component of the market and not really a very big component of the market overall. Out of a total notional value of about $700 trillion outstanding in this world, in the derivatives market, only $20 trillion of that is credit derivatives. So about only 1/35th or about 3% of the market is made up of credit derivatives. So they're not really a very large segment of the derivatives market when one thinks about it that way. So the question is, why has this market become of such importance? One way to look at the importance of this market is to look at how it's changed over time. Now, as I mentioned, credit derivatives were introduced relatively recently in this world, only 20 years ago, the time I became a financial economist. And in the initial years, the market was so small that organizations that keep track of these markets as if didn't even have an idea of how big the market was. 2004, when they first started keeping track of it, the market was about $8 trillion in size. By 2007, the market was $60 trillion in size. It had grown sevenfold in 3 years and become the second largest component of the world derivatives market. Suddenly, credit risk was a craze. Everybody was trading credit risk using credit derivatives. The market exploded, then the crisis hit, and the market is subsequently shrunk again. So the market size is now of the order of about $20 trillion in notional outstanding, and it's made up of both credit derivatives depend on single names and on multiple names, as I talked about shortly. So this is a market that has started out at zero, became the second largest component of the market, and is now shrunk again. But it still continues to be of impressive size and continues to be important in various ways. For those of you who prefer numbers, this table gives you an idea of how the market size has changed over time, from about 6.3 trillion in December 2004 to about 58 trillion in December 2007. Subsequently, as I said, the market has fallen off. It's now about 30% of the size it was in at the height of the just before the crisis. So one point to keep in mind about why we've seen this explosion in credit derivatives so recently and why this is a fairly recent phenomenon, it's important to keep this in mind in context. While credit risk is an aspect of economic activity that has been around as long as humans have had economic activity, the size of credit markets today is orders of magnitude different from what it was even two or three generations ago. So in 1950, banks were the main lenders. Now we have lenders in the form of finance companies, hedge funds, insurance companies, huge competition and huge number of people accessing these instruments. So when you look at the size of the market, the world bond market, crossed $100 trillion in 2012 from $82 trillion in 2008, grew almost 25% in a period of just 4 years. And the growth in explosion in debt has not been just a developed market phenomenon, it's been a worldwide phenomenon. So when you look at the number of sovereigns accessing international capital markets, in 1980, just 13 sovereigns were rated by credit by S&P and all had AAA ratings. There was no real credit risk in the sovereign market at that point. By 2015, this year, 10 times as many sovereigns are rated by S&P. Only 12 of them are rated AAA, and 59 of them, over 40% of them, have junk ratings. So the credit riskiness in the securities has become very, very large. So what has happened is the world has seen an explosion of debt and an explosion of credit risk, which has made the which has increased the necessity of having instruments to manage this risk, and that's why credit derivatives. That's why the credit derivatives field has grown so quickly. Part of this, of course, has to do with the cultural attitude, a change in our cultural attitude to debt itself. My parents' generation, certainly, it was inconceivable that you would borrow money to buy a television set. You borrow money only for things that were absolutely necessary. Our graduates today think nothing about borrowing money for every aspect of life that they're spending. They're beginning life with borrowed money, borrowed cars, borrowed this. Our attitude to debt has changed, and that has led to this explosion of debt borrowing. So this has led to pressures from the banking system, which I'll talk about shortly, for better ways of managing the kind of credit risk that they're facing. And simultaneously, in an unintended way, regulatory changes that were written before the era of credit derivatives gave an unexpected fillip to the credit derivatives market, where it became better for banks and other institutions to trade in credit derivatives rather than to trade in the underlying instruments. So what is a typical credit derivative? The prototypical credit derivative, the one that lay at the heart of what people thought was at the heart of the financial crisis, is a credit default swap. Now, a credit default swap is, in its most basic form, just a form of insurance. A credit default swap has two counterparties, one called a protection buyer, who's buying protection against default on some underlying credit risk instrument. Imagine a bank which has a loan on its books, is worried about the loan defaulting, buys protection on that loan by making a premium payment to a protection seller. So the protection seller is in the role of the seller of insurance, is able to insure the protection buyer against default on the reference asset. So if the underlying reference asset were to default, then the protection seller compensates the protection buyer for the loss suffered on account of the default, makes the buyer whole. That's all the prototypical credit derivatives. It's just an instrument where you buy insurance against default. So the simplest way to think of a credit derivative is you have a seller of insurance who's taking on the credit risk of the underlying instrument and a buyer of insurance who's getting rid of that credit risk. The alternative way to think of a credit derivative, which is an equivalent way, and I will explain why I'm mentioning two methods in a second, is that the protection seller is essentially in the role of somebody who has obtained the same kind of cash flows he would obtain if he actually held a bond without actually holding the bond. What do I mean by that? When you buy a bond, you get coupon payments from the bond, or the bond could default and you have to eat the loss given default. When you sell insurance, you get a steady stream of premium payments, like your coupons, but if the bond defaults, you have to compensate the buyer for loss given default. So from the standpoint of the protection seller, a credit default swap is an alternative way to buy a bond. It's an alternative to buying a bond. But the big difference between the two is that when you buy a bond, you have to pay cash for it upfront. When you sell protection, you get the cash flows and you only have to pay your cash if there's a default. So in other words, you're getting the cash flows from a bond without putting the cash down. That's leverage. And this leverage is an enormously important aspect of the credit derivatives market. Protection sellers alternatively could get the same kind of exposure by buying bonds, but that's expensive. So much better use of your capital. You sell protection instead. You have to post a small amount of collateral. But for that small amount of collateral, you get the same exposure you would have gotten had you bought a bond. So that's essentially a credit derivative. From the buyer's standpoint, one way to think of it is insurance. From the seller's standpoint, one way to think of it is I've got a synthetic bond. So when we think about credit derivatives, the credit default swap is the most important class of credit derivatives, but there are a bunch of other products also that are variants. For example, instead of writing a credit default swap on just one underlying reference obligation, you could write it simultaneously on a basket of obligations, and you get a payoff as soon as any of them default. So in my beginning comments, what I'm going to talk about is, as I said, the good, the bad, and the worrying aspect of this market. I prepared a very large number of remarks on this because this is a market and an academic literature that has absolutely exploded in the last 15 years or so. Ed, of course, was doing credit risk before, as he says, before credit risk existed. The rest of us got into this field relatively late and we've seen an explosion of work. So I'm going to, instead of going through all my slides, I'm going to focus on just what I consider the two key good points, two key bad points, and two key concerns, worries about credit derivatives. So on the good side, we can look at what is good about a credit derivative from the standpoint of the seller of credit risk, the person who's getting rid of credit risk, that is the person who's buying protection. From the standpoint of the seller of credit risk, put yourself in the place of a bank, you have this vast pool of credit risky instruments that you're holding, loans to various people, credit card loans, home loans. At some point, you may not want to keep all of these loans. There's somebody who's willing to take the loan off your books, who's willing to assume that risk, but selling loans is very difficult. It's difficult because the loan market is highly illiquid. So what can you do? You can use a credit derivative to sell the credit risk to them. So they now assume the credit risk and you've sold the credit risk off your books without selling the instrument. Keep in mind that the instrument remains with you, so all the voting rights, servicing rights, everything remains with you, but you no longer don't have to worry about the credit risk. From the standpoint of banks, this has enabled active portfolio management in a way that was inconceivable before credit derivatives were introduced. Earlier, you made a loan, that loan stayed on your books forever. If it went bad, it was your problem. Now you make a loan, other parties want the loan, you can sell the loan off to them so that enables active portfolio management. One of the strongest aspects of credit derivatives, it's enabled better portfolio management with anybody who holds a bond portfolio, a loan portfolio, a credit card portfolio, any credit risk instrument. From the standpoint of the buyer of credit risk, what's the main advantage? From the standpoint of the person who assumes this credit risk, why would you want to assume a credit risk voluntarily? because that's an entire asset class to which you had no access earlier. So for example, what credit derivatives have done is enable international access to assets by very local investors. If I'm a hedge fund located in New York and I want to invest in Turkish treasury bills, some years ago Turkey had a restriction that only people with a local presence were allowed to invest in Turkish treasury bills. So there was no way I could invest. The credit derivatives market comes along, I go to a global bank, I go to a Deutsche Bank, a Credit Suisse, and I tell them, buy the bond in Turkey and transfer the risk in the bond to me using a credit derivative. So indirectly, I get the protections. Seller has all the as I mentioned in this graph, the protection seller has all the attributes of somebody who owns the bond without actually owning the bond. So you can get indirect access to securities all over the world, and this has made the market for almost every asset in this world a global market and has pushed down asset prices. So that's been a tremendous benefit of credit derivatives. Before the credit derivatives market arose, most markets were local. Now you have investors sitting anywhere, you can invest in products anywhere by accessing the assets synthetically through a derivative. So from the standpoint of those who are looking to eliminate the credit risk, it's allowed them to actively manage portfolios. From the standpoint of those who are assuming the credit risk, it's given them access to assets to which they didn't have access earlier. The syndicated loan market in the US used to be primarily the domain of large banks who could participate in this market. Today, banks can make those syndicated loans and then use a credit derivative to effectively sell off the loans to a hedge fund or to an insurance company, anybody who wants to invest in them. So the two enormous benefits of credit derivatives have been, on the one hand, enabling better portfolio management by those who have to have credit risky instruments, and on the other hand, enabling access to an entire asset class to which access was denied earlier. So they've created global markets for every product, which has been, the effect has been phenomenal. But there is a but. I just pointed out a while ago that when I was looking at this picture, I said the protection seller is in the position of somebody who gets the cash flows he would have gotten from a bond but without buying the bond. That is, the protection seller has enormous leverage. Now, leverage is a very, very dangerous thing because leverage magnifies your profits when you invest but magnifies your losses when you invest. So the problem with leverage is, even though a derivative is ultimately a zero-sum transaction between two people, when one institution suffers very large losses, it has to make up those losses elsewhere, and that effect can ripple through the system, creating systemic crisis. So the first bag of credit derivatives is unchecked leverage and what it can do. So let me just briefly go through this slide. Then credit derivatives particularly got most of the blame for what happened in the financial crisis. But this was actually not true. The credit derivatives actually played a very small role in the financial crisis. Most of the financial crisis was caused by banks making horrendous loans, horrendous quality loans, then securitizing and selling them off to counterparties who then had to take the losses. But much of the market was created by just making poor loans and securitizing and selling off those poor loans. Credit derivatives were involved very peripherally, very, very few of these transactions actually involved credit derivatives. But credit derivatives became famous because of a few very large institutions. Everybody immediately thinks of AIG in this context. A few very large institutions, which were systemically important institutions, that had taken on enormous one-sided bets using credit derivatives. So AIG was the prototypical example of this, and almost the only major player who took on one-sided bets. What did AIG do? AIG had several problems. One was, a credit default swap is a very simple instrument where you provide insurance against one person's default. AIG decided to write very complicated credit derivatives which were on mortgage-backed securities, where if anybody in the mortgage defaulted, you would compensate the buyer. But when you're looking at a pool of 10,000 mortgages, you're looking at 10,000 little credits scattered all over the country. You have no idea who could default, who could not default, what's the likelihood of all of them defaulting together, and you're still willing to write protection on this, you're still willing to absorb the losses. So AIG was essentially playing a very, very difficult, what we call a correlation game. It was betting that the defaults would not all be correlated, that the entire housing market would not collapse at the same time, so everybody wouldn't default together. That is very complicated. Now AIG actually wrote $5.7 billion of protection. Imagine one company, $5.7 billion of protection. Only $78 billion of that was on these subprime mortgage-backed securities. And even on those, so this is, let me just emphasize this point. Even on those, AIG only agreed to compensate the buyers for losses above 35% of the portfolio. So the first 35% of the portfolio, AIG was not going to pay at time. But if losses on the portfolio crossed 35%, AIG had to eat the entire losses. When you sell portfolio insurance on mortgages, what you're betting is not enough people will default, that 35% of the portfolio is going to be lost. However, that's exactly what ended up happening. The entire mortgage market melted down, and AIG ended up having to bear an enormous part of the cost. But here's the hubris regarding AIG's own risk management. AIG had such faith in risk management. You have to read these quotes to believe them. The CEO, Robert Lewis, a year before the crisis said, it would take declines in housing values to reach depression proportions, along with default frequencies never before experienced before our AAA investments would be impaired. And the CFO, Joseph Casano, said, it is hard for us, without being flippant, to even see a scenario within any kind of realm of reason that would see us losing $1 of any of those transactions. There was the Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan, who, talking about the same credit derivatives, said, as a consequence of credit derivatives, he said, not only have individual financial institutions become less vulnerable to shocks, the financial system as a whole has become more resilient. One should always be very careful what one states in public. So that's, this was the one main problem. You get leverage and you have very poor risk management that doesn't know what kind of leverage you've taken on, what kind of risk you've taken on. You end up endangering the entire system. So if I had to pick the one biggest bad of credit derivatives, it is understanding the nature of the leverage and controlling the nature of the leverage. So let me skip past the slide. In a very recent paper of mine, so with two co-authors, I handled this question of how is it possible that instruments designed to share risk are actually making the world riskier rather than less risky. So the paper goes through a long argument, but it's essentially a very simple argument, underlying simple idea, that when you buy insurance, you think you're protected. You don't have to worry about it, so you go up and take more risk. When you don't have access to the insurance, you're going to be more careful. But the minute you have access to financial instruments that you can share risk with, you end up going and taking more risk. So actually, instruments to share risk can actually end up making the world riskier. We make a more subtle version of the point. Okay, the second bad, as I said, I'm going to point out two bads and two one. The second bad I point out is credit derivatives are a wonderful class of instruments, but in today's world, that risk is highly concentrated in just a handful of institutions. About 10 dealer banks account for more than 90% of the trading in this market. There are just five banks. Five banks is 0.1%. There are 5,000 people who trade in these markets. Five banks account for 50% of all the net selling in these markets. So enormous concentration risk. If 50% of the selling, remember when you sell protection and there's a meltdown, you have to take the losses. So if 50% of the selling is being run by five institutions, you can imagine the kind of systemic risk that we are running and the burden we are putting on regulators to make sure that this risk doesn't spill over. So there's a study by one of our recent PhD students at Stern, Sigmar Dine, did a magnificent thesis looking at the impact of concentration. And what he showed empirically was the data shows that day-to-day fluctuations in the capital held by these banks has very significant impacts on how much they charge for protection. What they're charging for protection is not just based on the credit risk of the underlying entity, but actually on how much they are losing and gaining in other markets. So there's a transfer effect that's taking place, and he's done a very detailed, very beautiful analysis of this, and pointed out that this creates potentially very serious systemic fragility. Until Amy's paper pointed this out much more formally, I think lots of us were used to thinking of CDS pricing as standalone pricing. How much risk is there in this instrument? How should I price it? Now we have an idea that you're really pricing risk on a portfolio basis where you're looking at what else you could lose elsewhere, therefore how much are you willing to charge for this? So two main points. Okay. On the worries. So I've talked about what is good about credit derivatives, what is bad about credit derivatives. Let me talk about two major concerns about this market. Now here I'm going to go away from looking at the derivative aspect, but looking at a more corporate finance nature from the standpoint of who owns securities in a firm and why do they own it. A fundamental organizing principle of our entire economic system is that voting rights in a firm should belong to those who have economic exposure to that firm. The number of votes you have depends on the number of shares you have. This is a fundamental principle that only those who have economic exposure should vote on issues concerning the firm. So when you look at ownership of shares, that not only gives you economic rights to being the residual claimant of profits, but also gives you voting rights on the firm's operations and gives you disclosure obligations and other obligations. If you own debt in a firm, similarly, you get certain rights, which is rights to periodic cash flows, and you get control rights. If those rights are violated, you don't get the contractual cash flows. You have the right then to either waive the cash flows or put the firm into bankruptcy, and then you have the right to participate in bankruptcy proceedings. The basic idea is, as a debt holder, I have economic exposure to the firm, so if the firm is in distress, I have the right to vote on what should happen to the firm. And the critical problem in designing bankruptcy systems through the world has been, how do you design a bankruptcy system that ensures solvent firms are recapitalized and emerge again, and insolvent firms are just liquidated? So how do you create an efficient bankruptcy system? Our entire presumption in this is that when you own equity, you have economic exposure. When you own debt, you have economic exposure. But what happens if you're a debt holder who's bought protection on the firm? You bought protection on your debt. So I've loaned the firm money as a bank, then I've got out and bought CDS protection. I've transferred the risk in the bond away to somebody else and the loan to somebody else. But I haven't transferred the loan. So I still have the voting rights, but I don't have economic exposure. Now what happens? Firm approaches bankruptcy. I have no interest in taking the effort to see should this firm continue, should this firm not continue. My interests are protected. I'm always going to get paid whatever happens. So my interest right now is to just resolve the problem quickly, push the firm through bankruptcy and return. So that's how the AP credit card problem, the name was given by two lawyers, Ho and Black, who were the first to point out that credit derivatives have challenged a fundamental presumption underlying our securities laws. Our securities laws give voting rights to those with economic exposure because it's presumed they actually have that exposure. Our securities laws do not require you to disclose, have you transferred away that exposure to somebody else and merely kept the voting rights on your books. So, Ho and Black provided the informal arguments on this context from a legal economic perspective, very, very detailed set of papers. But as they said at that point, data is very hard to obtain. Is this really a problem or not? We don't yet know. There's a follow-up paper that Bolton and Unke wrote in 2011 that pointed out actually there are two sides to this. If a firm feels that whenever it's approaching bankruptcy, its lenders are going to push it into bankruptcy because they already are protected, then firms are going to take extra effort to not get into bankruptcy. That is, for example, they hold larger cash, and this is a positive thing. So it's not only a negative thing, it's a positive thing. But on the downside, if you do get into distress, you're going to be pushed into bankruptcy. There'll be too many defaults, violent firms will be closed. The evidence of this is mixed. Right now, we're at the very beginning of studying what kind of an empirical problem this is, because the data is very hard to get. Lenders are not going to tell you that I already bought protection, I didn't care when I pushed this firm into bankruptcy. So we have to use very indirect methods to find out what did lenders actually have in the form of protection during bankruptcy crisis and so on. So the data on this is very mixed. There's some suggestion that having CDS contracts, lenders are actually more willing to lend when they can protect themselves through CDS contracts. There's some evidence that in bankruptcy you're more likely to go bankrupt, but there's some evidence that you're less likely to go bankrupt. But there is clear evidence that you keep more cash in the firm. Firms on which CDSs are traded, they are worried that the bankers will be pushing them into bankruptcy quickly, so they tend to keep more cash. That's fairly clear evidence in corporate governance. So I put this as a worrying because we don't know the impact. This challenges our entire securities law structure. But isn't it something that we should be concerned about or not? At this stage, the empirical evidence is mixed. Should we require, for example, people participating in bankruptcy to reveal what protection they have? You know, at this stage, we don't know whether we should or not. Whether we should for reasons of too much bankruptcy or not, but perhaps the law will change that. The second great worry about this market is the sheer opacity of the market. It's hard to think of a market that is more opaque than this market. And I'll give you just one example to discuss this opacity. Now, in a credit default swap, the seller of protection pays the buyer of protection if there is a default. Now, you would think that default is a public event. There should be no issue about this. But it turns out that in practice, there are many gray areas where it's not clear that there's a default or not. So how is it actually settled in the credit default swap market? You have a committee called the Determinations Committee. The Determinations Committee makes binding, non-appealable decisions on whether a credit event has occurred or not, and they don't have to tell you why they voted the way they did. So who's this Determinations Committee? It turns out the 10 largest banks dealing in this business and the 5 largest buy-side funds dealing in this business are the Determinations Committee. Now they are the people participating in the market, and then they get to determine whether a credit event occurred or not. They don't have to disclose their conflict of interest. This is, you think that this is the most basic thing, right? If you have a conflict of interest, you should at least tell people what your conflict of interest is, but they don't have to. They make binding, non-appealable decisions that are on which they don't have to explain their conflict of interest. Until 2012, they did not even have to explain whether they voted yes or no. But after November 2012, they now tell you which way they voted, but not why. So if I'm a bank that has sold a lot of protection and I may take a large loss if something is declared a default, I have an obvious incentive to say a default didn't occur. But we are given the ISDA gives us no information about bank holdings before they vote on determinations committees. It's hard to think of a legal system that could be worse than this, that has an obvious conflict of interest, which are not required to disclose. And this is, the rulings are binding and non-appealable on everybody. Worse yet, if the determinations committee is not able to come to an agreement, they meet again 2 weeks later, and nobody is prohibited from trading in those 2 weeks where you can go out and buy additional protection. You're not required to say that you did or not. You already have a sense of the room. You already have a sense of how people are going to vote. And we've seen this happen many times. Greece, all of us think of the Greek default in 2012. Not in CDS market. The CDS market's determinations committee on February 29th of 2012 said Greek had not defaulted, but the whole world thought Greek had defaulted. 9 days later, they turned around and said, yes, it was a default. But in those 9 days, the members of the determinations committee, their banks, could have gone and traded in these instruments for all we know. So that's one of the most worrying aspects of this market. I put it as a worry because there's no evidence yet that there's been a real problem. But certainly, it fails the smell test. Opacity in this market also comes about in banks' holding of derivatives positions. If you look after the crisis, some banks, their holdings of derivatives position has been climbing at dizzying rates again. Citibank had $32 billion of derivatives in 2009, today holds $73 billion. Now, Citi was one of the most troubled banks during the crisis. Suddenly, they doubled their CDS positions in six years. So, question is, why are they doing this? Are the regulators being vigilant enough, or is this again gaming the regulatory system? It's hard for an outsider to make out. You know, the positions are so complex that you have no idea whether regulators are on top of this, or maybe the regulatory capital, the regulatory system is still not adequate to guard against this kind of risk. So this is again a major worry that the next crisis might be getting underway and we're not aware of what's going on. Several people actually believe that this is. So, to summarize my remarks, this is an enormously useful class of products in many ways. The world before credit derivatives and the world after credit derivatives are two separate worlds. We cannot even imagine the changes that occur in this world in terms of asset access. You can access assets anywhere in the world, from anywhere in the world using credit derivatives. But this growth is not being without problems. Some of the concerns that I've discussed here are purely operational concerns. The determinations committee, for example, perhaps some regulatory intervention will make the determinations committee a little more objective. But some of the other concerns I've listed here are much more challenging. The regulatory arbitrage by banks, the capture of or gaming the regulatory system using credit derivatives, the opacity of holdings, and especially, how should our bankruptcy system start taking into account credit protection held by creditors? There's still a huge amount that we don't know and are yet to learn about the system. We're still looking to learn about the system. biggest challenge in this entire thing has been, as it always is, data. Data is almost completely controlled by the banks. So only last week, on behalf of NYU, I talked to the sole holder of CBS data, a company called Market. DCC also has data, but it's much more difficult getting it from them. Market has data, and so I asked them what their best academic price was to give us the data. He said, $28,500 a year, there's no academic price, there's only one price. $28,500 a year for the data. It's a 3-year contract, and at the end of 3 years, the data has to be purged. Meaning, if you haven't finished your research, well, then too bad. You know, the data's gone for. This is the problem with doing research in this area. You get very poor aggregated data on prices. You don't get any data on holdings, who holds the data, who holds the debt, on whom do they hold the instruments, and so on. So we have a very long way to go, and hopefully regulators will wake up one day to the importance of researchers in this area and start providing us with this data the way other markets. So regulators have clamped down very, very significantly on all derivatives trading, including credit derivatives, which is why a lot of European banks, for example, are shedding their derivatives business. So certainly the more risky aspects of it, Credit Suisse was earliest to get out of all emerging markets business altogether. Deutsche Bank recently sold $250 billion of a credit derivatives portfolio to Citigroup. Why Citi wants to assume this? Are US regulators being more lax? Are we that far behind European regulators in implementing the new regulations? I don't know. So clearly there's a lot of work to be done in this area. These have been very useful instruments. We don't want to ban the use of these instruments because, as I've said, they've reduced asset prices throughout the world. They've made loans more easy to get because of the hedging possibilities. So we don't want to, what we want to make sure is only one thing, that they don't pose systemic threats. One bank has to fail because it took bad debts. That's fine. When they start threatening the system, that becomes a problem. So regulators, I think, need to ask for better disclosure of what banks are doing and disclose that to the general public. Right now, regulators may know what they're doing, but investors don't. So that information needs to be much more public. I think this is really an issue of information more than anything else.
Three-part question. First, they've tried.
You're telling my memory now.
Yes. They've tried to put many of these swaps and derivatives onto regulated exchanges. Where's the status of that? Number two, back in 03 and 04, if I recall, the SEC allowed virtually leverage to go untouched when they exposed and allowed major firms to go from 10 to 15 to 1 to 30, 40, 50 to 1. Mm-hmm. Where does that stand from a systemic risk? And number four, can you tell me, because I can still never understand your opinion as to why. Why the United States government, in giving all that benefit to AIG, allowed $60, $70 billion to go offshore to those banks without a hair?
On the first question, yes, I think one of the greatest advantages of moving everything onto to centralized clearinghouses, to the swap exchange facilities, as they're called. So a huge part of that migration has already started occurring. Even as of 3 years ago, more than $30 trillion of swaps have been cleared by the LCH alone.
Right.
Today, a very large part of the CDS contracts are going through central clearing houses. So that's been all to the good. Now, what we need is much more to move. And what we need is much more transparency about what the central clearing houses are doing, because these are not, now you've transferred all the risk to the clearing houses, but if the clearing houses collapse, we all collapse again. So we need to have much more information about the clearing houses, what kind of capital are they holding, what kind of risk management systems are they running. We need to vet those. That's all written into the Dodd-Frank Act, but we have very little information about how it's being implemented at this stage. There's still time for the implementation to occur, but we're moving in the right direction. My only fear is that we're not moving fast enough when we see some banks ramping up at this pace. I told you my memory is getting challenged. Your second question was
on leverage.
Leveraging. So at the height of the crisis, or even before the crisis, insurance companies, particularly like MBIA and AmBank, had 100-to-1 leverages. 100-to-1 leverage. Fannie and Freddie were running 100-to-1 leverage. Banks were running 30-to-1 leverage. Since the crisis, most banks have deleveraged very significantly. And these stress tests that are being done by the regulatory authorities, the ECB and the Fed, are largely meant to check that also. The available information, I mean, last year, as you know, in Europe, many of the banks actually failed the stress tests. This was not designed to give confidence to the markets, but hopefully they are further deleveraging on account of that. At least they are doing the test they weren't doing a few years ago. So I think that much is made to the goal. On the AIG bailout, I think it's very, very hard to understand why no Hackett was charged. A huge part of the money, as you said, went to foreign banks. Even the money that went to the US banks, actually many of it, the banks were just passed through. They had other counterparties to whom they had to post the collateral. But the issue was, when you had this power, why couldn't you use a Hackett on all the banks, or a different Hackett on different banks? I think there was at least some conflict of interest in, I shouldn't say this, but our Treasury Secretary was heading to New York Fed at that time. This, he was talking to the bankers all the time. It's hard to believe that that didn't have an impact. It was a terrible decision. I think there were many terrible decisions we made during the crisis. One of them was we built an economic system based on the idea that if you make profits, you get to keep it, but if you make losses, you get to eat them. And we instead said that you privatize profits, but you socialize pain. In October of 2008, Edmund, remember this, one of our colleagues from Wharton, Franklin Allen, had come to Stern to give a talk. And this was at the height of the crisis, right? But people were in panic mode at that point on what to do. Franklin was very, very clear. He said, if you bail out the banks, you're going to regret it. What you should do is immediate government takeover of all the banks, wipe out all the bondholders, wipe out all the equity holders, and announce a plan today to privatize them in 3 years. He said the system will be saved, but people will learn a lesson. And I told him, frankly, that is not possible today. Today I realize how correct it was. At that time, I too thought that an immediate bailout was not required. I think we learned, the banks have learned all the wrong lessons from this. So I think the Hackett was the least of the problems in terms of the incentives we've given the system.
You mentioned Greece. I'm just curious if you've noticed, are the credit derivative markets saying anything to us now about the current situation in Greece?
I haven't actually followed it in the last 2 months. I suspect that there's nobody willing to write protection on Greece right now.
No. If you back out the probability of default from the premium on the CDS market,
yes,
for Greece today, it says that. It said, this was about a month ago, the probability was over 90%.
Yeah.
Within 5 years. And
these are 5 years.
Contracts are written for 5 years, so we're not talking about next week or not, but you can back out at least next week from the time series of the data. But yes, the market was saying more than 90% probability that Greece would default again. Market was wrong for a long time before. And I'd like to bring up something that Roger was talking about, and that is this committee that determines if there's a default or not. Fraught with conflicts of interest. And I was arguing in Congress and other places that this was a terrible thing that was going on. Because this committee, by the way, is part of, you didn't mention it, ISDA. The International Swaps and Derivatives Association, which has jurisdiction over all derivative trading. And it made up of these 15 institutions, many of whom could be holding big amounts of derivatives themselves, as we probably said. So for a long time, they voted that Greece had not defaulted. It wasn't just a week before, which was true also, but they had been voting that it was not a default when they hadn't been paying their interest. And that the argument was that it was not a default because none of the creditors, at least at that time, everybody had agreed that it was to give them more time. Right? And as long as there wasn't any holdouts for that, it was not a default. Then finally, it became a default only because Greece themselves changed the rules. And they said that we will not default because under our law, we can do what we want. But about 10% or so of their hedge funds are owned with debt. Greece said, no, we're under British law, not the going to be written with this, and in the British law, we can demand payment. And then Greece said, no, no, force majeure, we will not pay you, or we will only pay you 20 cents on the dollar, 21 cents on the dollar. And then the committee had to say it was a default, because they said we will only get 21 cents on the dollar, and we're forcing it down those who do not agree. So,
what happened was that the way a credit event is written in the credit default swap contracts, the credit event, if a company defaults and its creditors voluntarily accept a default, it's not a default. So when Greece was in danger of default, the ECB forced all the banks holding Greek debt to voluntarily accept a write-down of their debt. A huge hedge fund held out and said they would not, they said, we are not going to allow, they were in London, they said we are not going to accept this. So Greece then passed a collective action clause that said if 75% tender, we have the right to force it down everyone's throat. And they passed it with retroactive, going back to the 1960s or something. And then they were able to invoke the collective action clause to force the hedge funds to agree. And when involuntary agreement happened, it became a credit. So on February 9th, it was not yet a credit event because it was not yet clear there was any involuntary thing. And then by March 9th, they said, okay, it's involuntary. To the whole world, the write-down was a heck, is a default. But not to Israel, the United Nations.
Let me just
add
one thing. Pardon me?
What was that
default?
2009,
actually. So prior to the 2009 formation of the committee, the market was standardized completely in 2009, but the announcement of the standardization was made in 2006. But prior to the formation of the committee, every time a default happened, if I had bought protection, I would have to negotiate with each of my sellers to get paid. But then the Central Determinations Committee was created to make binding determinations. Great idea, except for the conflict.
Was it created to avoid an AIG problem?
No, because there were many disputes in the market, again and again, over whether or not something constituted a default. How was compensation to be paid in the event of default? So all those things got standardized. Because otherwise, so there were cases from Conseco to Nomura to the many RegTrack, many of those cases where there was continuous conflict about how did default occur, how much compensation should I pay, so on. So everything got standardized in 2000. The standardization is a great idea. It's only the conflict of interest that is not a great idea.
Yes, part of the problem, by the way,
and the assumption that they were making was roughly the same assumption that the banks were making and that AIG was making, that all these mortgages are not going to default together. All the US mortgage market going down at the same time, real estate market going down at the same time, was not a likely. That's the, I think, the kind explanation. The not so kind explanation is that this was a tremendous growth area rating these things, and there was tremendous competition amongst the ratings agencies. So they revealed their methodology to the banks of how they would do the ratings, and allowed banks to game the system. Because, for example, a pool of mortgages was rated based on the average FICO score. Now, if you want an average FICO score of, let's say, 600, I can put in only 600s into the mix, or I can put in a few 700s and a few 400s. Now, the 400s are going to be a very, very high likelihood of default. So the ratings agencies were looking, they were using very crude metrics to do this gauging. And a good part of the problem was that the kind of models they were employing were very easily capable. So I think they've learned their lesson. I think they've been under such scrutiny after that from the regulators, from markets, from everyone else. But on the corporate side, I think they largely got things right. I mean, they
I've argued that for many years. That the rating of plain vanilla bonds and loans, they do an excellent job.
2007? July 2007.
What's that?
Are we in a new credit paradigm? Your paper.
Oh, yeah.
So in which you made the same point about corporate, on the corporate side. So credit spreads have been going to historically unseen levels. They've been narrowing so much you could buy 5-year protection on Brazil at 15 basis points a year. But Ed pointed out that we've never seen so few defaults either. So people who wanted to justify the spread said we are in a new era. They always say we are in a new era. So we are in a new era. We are at a permanent historical low in defaults. So the low spreads are justified. That logic was also applied not only to the mortgage market, but to the subprime mortgage market, which is where all the problems arose. There was a lot of hubris there. And Ed's paper was precisely asking the question, are we in a new era or are we merely seeing the calm before the storm? And he published it in July 2007, which was the month that spread broke out, if you remember the timing. So I remember it well.
That's our call, by the way.
Oh, I'm sorry, did I speak too long?
No, you're fine.
One more question there, and then we've got.
The question I have is about Citigroup's exposure. Seems like the corporate structure in Citigroup has no memory. 1989, 1990, and back in 1972. Are they absolutely have no records in Citigroup? That $80 billion off balance sheet losses, and nobody went to jail in Citigroup. Nobody's arrested. I just got in mind. I'm chairman from Citigroup. But I'm just telling you straight. It's a disaster.
Just
one
comment.
Comment about student loans. In bankruptcy, are these the only loans that cannot be forgiven? And if that's the case, how vulnerable, for example, are grandparents who sign on to these loans?
Until you question is why it's subject not to default. You know what? Even if the kid died, God forbid, in an accident, still his parents need to pay for it.
Exactly.
This is outrageous. If you think about it,
it's crazy.
From a distributional point of view, this is amazing how the university professor. I'm sitting and not really crying before, crying crazy.
Exactly.
We give up to all the banks and we don't give up to our